how to be a better lover.
Well, we are about at the midpoint of our series, and hopefully you're learning tips and tricks on how to be a better lover, right? That's just exactly what you want to hear this morning. But we've got some amazing insight coming up. First of all, if you are on your phone, if not, grab it real quick. Get on a Facebook-enabled device. Share the live stream that's going on right now. And like I say, tag somebody who isn't here, who you want to encourage, because they need to hear not just this series, but what God has to say to them. So as we've been going through this series, we've talked about two different boxes, right? The Xbox, which one in three human beings now identify as a gamer, so we kind of understand this idea that if we're going to get something out of that box, we've got to give it time, energy, money. We've got to put our lives into that in some ways, and it just gets worse and worse, right? The further you get, the more you want to reach that next level. But when it comes to the love box, we have this idea that our relationships are just automatically going to have everything we've ever hoped, dreamed about, and asked for. But the two are very similar. If we're going to get something out of a relationship, we have to put certain things into that relationship. Now, most of those who are on gaming devices nowadays have one in their pockets, right? It's this little cell phone that has an app store and you play games on it. But there's something else that I use this for a lot of times. And I can't say it out loud because everybody's phone would start going, yes, what can I do for you? But it's this magic device called Siri. Siri is that personal assistant that sits in all of our pockets, and it springs to action sometimes when you give the right commands, and then it also sometimes accomplishes those things in ways that are just like magic. But let me just ask you, have you ever been in the presence of someone and you just have that weird crystallizing moment where you realize they're a better person than you? I have those moments every time I'm around my wife when we're both trying to use Siri. Because this is my wife. She'll say, hey Siri, would you please play my Taylor Swift playlist? And if it was, you know, the old Tom and Jerry cartoons, you'd see the little angels floating around and stuff. And when it's me, you would see, well, let's just say a red background. And I'm like, Siri, get this done now. And then when it fails, let me just tell you, my next round with Siri is like I'm yelling at the thing because this piece of plastic and glass knows what I'm trying to get out of it, right? It doesn't hurt anybody to get mad at my cell phone. And yet, I had this conversation with my wife. I said, why are you so nice to Siri? And she said, you know what, Lee? I am not gonna let my being a kind person be changed whether it's a Siri or whether it's a person at the grocery store or whether it's someone in traffic. And I just kind of had to hang my head and go, you're right. You're so right. Because my rudeness, if I can call it that, to Siri kind of spills over into other places, right? The Bible says, he who is faithful with something that is very little will be faithful with something big, with much. And my expressions of anger towards Siri sometimes spill out into other places. This is none of you, I realize, right? But let's just imagine you're in traffic and there's somebody else who's kind of alongside you, but they're going just a little too slow or just a little too fast, or they're right alongside you and won't get out of the way. They're anywhere around you and you are yelling at that person, maybe like in a muffled breath so that the people in the car next to you don't hear you. And yet it's that same thing. How long until I'm yelling at Siri, then I'm yelling at someone in the car, and then I have an outburst towards my kids or towards my family. Not something mean, but just something rude. Something that just kind of is short and direct. In his book, How to Win Friends and Influence People, this classic work, Dale Carnegie says this. He says, rudeness is the cancer that devours love. Think about that. Rudeness is the cancer that devours love. And so we are trying to put good things into the love box so that in our relationships, we have peace and joy, we have kindness, we have all of those wonderful things we've always wanted. But did you know that there's things that you can put into the love box that work like cancer? And Scripture talks a lot about them. So if you would, turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter, as it were. And as you're turning there, you know, if you don't have a Bible of your own, you can grab one in the pew right there in front of you. You can also download one from bible.com/app and use that. Those are yours to take either way. But here's what the Bible has to say about love devourers. After it starts out with saying love is patient, love is kind, then it starts saying this: love does not envy. It is not boastful. It is not arrogant. It is not rude. There's that one right there. It is not self-seeking. It's not irritable, and it does not keep a record of wrongs. Now, this week, we're going to focus on these right here, this envy, boastfulness, rudeness. Next week, we're going to talk about what it means to remove the self and to not feed the me monster. And then Gabe is going to tell us about not keeping a record of wrongs. But I would wage a guess that when it comes to this irritability and rudeness, you and I both probably just dismiss it, don't we? It's not a big deal. It's a piece of plastic with a screen on it. It's not even a real human. It's a person in a car, and they, you know, they should know. They know what they did. They deserve my angry scowl. And yet, as we dig into what the Bible says about love, it clearly tells us that our love cannot be rude. It cannot be arrogant. It cannot be boastful. And so what do we need to know from this? If you're following along in your impact guides, on page 30, you can take notes for the sermons. You can find some devotionals. And I want you to think about this key thought: real love must know in order to grow. Real love must know in order to grow. But notice the word know is kind of a two-way street, right? There's no like get away, and there's no like I know you. And we got to look at both of them really briefly to see the prescription that Scripture has to eliminate these love devourers. Because I'm willing to bet in your relationships, not just in marriage, not just in dating, but with your coworkers, with your friends, that you want to have a better interaction. You want to have a better feeling of camaraderie. But if we have these love devourers in the way, it eats up, kind of like Pac-Man. Anybody remember Pac-Man? There was the whole Pac-Man fever thing. Like, it goes around, it just gobbles up all the dots. That's what those love devourers do for us. But the hard thing is, until you're in that moment where somebody else kind of points it out, it's often hard to see what's right in front of our faces. So how do we know if we have love devourers that are in our relationships? Well, it's kind of like when you go to the doctor. You got to ask some of those initial questions that help you define. So let's look at a series of questions here that'll help us define if these are a part of our life. So in your relationships, have you ever sat down and just imagined that the grass is always greener, right? It's always gonna be better if I just did this, or if she just did this. It's always gonna be better if maybe we could just have this. And it's never about what you have right now. It's always about what's over there. And look, I don't wanna be too rude because, you know, that's not love. But I've heard it said, and it's a wise saying, that there's always a reason why the grass is greener elsewhere. Do you know what makes grass greener? Fertilizer. Think about that for just a second. Let's go on to the next question. What are you above in your relationships? What are you above? So put it this way. What is the thing that if your friend or your dating partner or maybe even your spouse were to say, hey, could you do this? That you'd be like, no, that's not even me. And yet you know that they would do that thing for you. That's rudeness. That's arrogance. Hey, would you do the dishes? No. That's your job. Would you clean the pipes? Oh, no. That's your job. I am above that. That's arrogance. What's next here? What have you focused on in somebody else that's maybe good or even better than that person that you're dating, that person you're married to, that person in your friendship? And yet in doing so, you ignore all of the many things that are good about the person you're with. Again, none of us are guilty about this, right? You see that other person and you see one thing that maybe even attracts you more, or that one thing that draws you in, and you just think, oh man, if only he or if only she had this one thing. And yet you're reducing that person down to one feature when all of the amazing ways that they are, you know, good and loving and caring, and you're just focusing on that one last little aspect. That's envy. Or have you ever said to someone that you're close to, you always do this, or you never do this? You've never said those words, right? We have never said those words to each other. That's that keeping record of wrongs. Or maybe, just maybe you've gone on social media, or you've been to a place where they make your hair look better, or maybe you've even been in the very halls of this church and you have put somebody else on blast. Nobody, right? I didn't see any guilty nods right there. None at all. It's just right there. Think about this. We go to some place, we go to social media, or we go to a salon or whatever, and we have this unintentional agenda to make ourselves feel better. And we say, oh, this person, they just always. And that other person's like, oh man, you are right. They are rotten. You deserve so much better than that. I wouldn't do that to myself. I wouldn't let that slide if I were you. And yet, don't we always have this nice tendency to share all the things that they did and just never say how we instigated those things ourselves? We never share how we had a role in it. It's just, oh, let's be mad at that person together, right? These are some heart checks, because these things are love devourers. They are love devourers. And if we allow them in our lives, if we allow them to continue in our relationships, then not only will that love box start out empty, but it'll stay empty. But that's not what Jesus wants for our lives. Remember, Jesus said that you will know, the world will know that you are my disciples because of your love for one another. But if love is to grow, it's got to know. So turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. Just flip over from 1 Corinthians to Ephesians. And we're going to take a look at the prescription that God is going to give us for how to get rid of these love devourers. So Ephesians chapter 4, starting near the end in verse 31, says this: let all bitterness, anger, wrath, shouting, and slander be removed from you. What does that word remind you of? It's kind of like a surgery word, isn't it? It's a surgical word. Let these things be removed. Don't feed them. Don't let them grow. Just get them out of the way. And then I love how it also says at the end, oh yeah, also along with all malice. These are big words. These are important things. Anger leading to, beyond that, to wrath, to shouting, to hatred. Keep going in verse 32. It says, now instead, be kind and compassionate. Be compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as Christ also forgave you. And then in verse 1 of chapter 5, it says, therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children and walk in love as Christ also loved us and gave himself for us a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. So if I was going to give you a little bottle of medicine that said, here's how you overcome the love devourers in your life, this would be it right here. And it would have three steps to it. The first one would be to know yourself. Know yourself, not the N-O side this time, but the K-N-O-W side. Because it says right in there, just as God also forgave you. Because the reality is when we have anger, wrath, malice, oftentimes we find ourselves in that same situation as that barbershop environment or that social media environment where we are magnifying the wrongs of the other person, but forgetting our own role in what's come to pass. Forgetting that God forgave us from an amazing debt. And therefore, we should extend that grace over to others. We've got to know ourselves. I'm sorry, know each and individual ourselves. But here's another way this plays into the relationships. You've got to know when you tend to demand a little bit more from relationships than you expect from the other. How many of you heard the idea, and I am going to say marriage here for a second, focus on that, but how many of you have heard the idea that marriage is 50-50? Few of you, right? Okay. What's the expectation there? I'm going to meet you in the middle. You're going to come this far, and then maybe I'll come this far. Or maybe I'll come this far so that you'll come this far, and we're going to meet right here in the middle. But what happens? The other person doesn't meet exactly where we think they should meet. And all of a sudden, we're saying, oh, well, I would do my part, but they don't have my best interests at heart. They're not meeting me halfway. Well, I hate to tell you, but 50-50 isn't the definition of marriage. It's literally the definition of divorce. You want 50-50? That's where it happens. And so we say, okay, all right, 80-20 then, right? I'll just expect that they'll do 80 and I'll do 20, and that'll be the perfect relationship right there. Oh, I meant, sorry, the other way. I should do 80 and they'll do 20. But then where do we define that line? We have to know ourselves because we tend to give ourselves the benefit of the doubt. We tend to forgive ourselves. We tend to say, oh, I'm only doing 49 right now. They're doing the 51%. But guess what? I'm okay with me, right? When we realize that Jesus gave 100% for us, it helps us to see where we should rethink the whole percentage calculation thing entirely. Now, I'm not allowing for abusive relationships. I'm not allowing for someone who never does anything. But the reality is, for most of us, we got to get away from 50-50 thinking. The second thing is, we need to know the other. We need to know that other person. It says, be kind and compassionate to one another. Can I tell you a secret? I have never been compassionate to someone I don't know. I've been compassionate in a general sense. You know, you see the commercials and they've got the Sarah McLachlan commercial and they're like, if you don't donate $10 today, this dog is going to die. You're like, oh my gosh, I've got to do something about it. But I've never met someone that I didn't get to know more and start to have compassion on them in a deeper and more real sense. You know, this came to light to me when I was in college. I met my wife and my wife and I started dating and I had this way that I like to express my affection for her, which was to buy little things and kind of leave them where she would find them. And my favorite of these, because, you know, at the time, this was the most amazing thing ever, were these little candies called Yogos. I know nobody remembers them but me. They were these yogurt-covered dots of candy and joy and all of your hopes and dreams as they melted in your mouth. And I don't know why Kellogg's canceled them, but I want to start a petition, save the Yogos, bring them back. But I used to leave these for Renee. And then, because 50-50, or in my case, 80-20 mindset, I would just wait for her to come to me and say, "Were you the one who left the Yogos out? Aren't you sweet? That was the most amazing thing ever." And she didn't do it. I was like, what's going on here? Okay, wait, maybe I'm just not going big enough. And so I started buying bigger things for her. And she'd say thank you. It wasn't like she was unappreciative. But there was never that gushing moment where she was just like, "You are the best boyfriend ever. No other guy would go to the store and buy a $2 box of candy and leave it for me." It took a long time for me to understand what was going on. And it wasn't actually until we were already married and a couple years in that I had this revelation. We were studying in our small group something that you will see, hint, hint, wink, wink, on page 33 of your impact guides. Page 33 of your impact guides, a resource that could change your life. We started going through this book called The Five Love Languages. Anybody know of that one, gone through it? Okay, a few of you. That's good. That's good. So Leonor talked last week about the four words that are used in the Bible for love. This is the five ways that we express love or that we receive love. And guess what? My wife and I speak different love languages. In fact, as you can expect, they're quite opposite from one another. My love language is gifts. You give me something, I'm like, "Oh, you love me. You really love me." But guess what? That doesn't fill my wife's love tank, as it were, as they say in the book. They use this analogy about how we try to talk to people or communicate with people through our love language. That's exactly what I was doing. I was giving her little tokens of, you know, my wallet, basically. But what she needed was words of affirmation. She still, that's her love language. And guess what I am absolutely worst at in life? Speaking words of affirmation. And so I am trying to give my wife from my love language, but she's not hearing it. It's like when you try to put diesel in a gasoline engine. It just doesn't run on that. And so I had to be kind and compassionate. I'm still learning that if I am going to show my wife love the way that she can hear it and understand it, I have to tell her how amazing she's doing. I have to tell her how excited I am, how proud of her I am. And sometimes I can still buy her little gifts, but that's more for me than it is for her. I've recognized, I still go and buy little things, but I know that I'm not doing it to fill love, her love tank. I'm just doing it so I can feel like I expressed in my way. And I'm working on that. I'm getting better at that. But each and every one of us, if we are going to love someone else, we need to learn how they receive love. And then the last thing we see in this verse is we've got to know Jesus. Now, I don't mean to shock you, and I don't mean to repeat myself too much, but here's the deal. Jesus is the source of love. It's a part of his nature and character. We can't find it anywhere else and claim that it's real love. So it says in that verse, be imitators of God. Walk in love. You know who else called us to walk with him? It's Jesus. He said, come with me. Let's take a walk. Let's take a journey together. And the reality is, the more that we become like Jesus, the more we love others. Because Jesus teaches us to die to ourselves instead of being selfish and self-centered and self-focused. Jesus tells us to have compassion on others and to look not what on the outside of what the world sees, but to look at what God sees on the inside. The more we become like him, the more closely we are able to love others. So how do we do that? Well, as I continue to share with you, there's different ways that we as a church are here to help you live a Jesus-centered life and to become more like him. And it's not about some little booklet that we put out, but it's about a process or a rhythm of getting into habits that make your life better. Because here's the deal. I know my wife's love language is words of affirmation. But if I don't go out of my way and do something different, I'm going to fall right back into the habit of giving her things and wondering why she's not loving me the way I want to be loved. We have to break our cycles. We have to break our habits. And guess what? Summer's coming up. Some of us have already had kids that are out of school, or it's coming up this next week. And so for each of us, we're about to have this cycle break, right? This change in pace to some way or another. What would it look like if this summer you decided that maybe if it's just a few times a week, you were going to dig into your Bible? Maybe it's just a few times a week you're going to set aside time to pray. Maybe it's just a few times over the summer you're going to get together with some friends. You're going to get into a life group. You're going to discuss or talk about or share together what it means to follow Jesus and how you can draw closer to him. How would your life change if you just took those intentional steps? So your next step, it's simple. I want you from now until Father's Day to consider diving into this resource. It's got 3 times a week that you can gather together, or that you can sit on your own with God and read and study and pray through some aspect of God's word. Because here's what I had to learn. When it came to my relationship with God, I wasn't treating it the same way I was treating my relationships with others. It was as if this was some holy relationship where I could only come if I was wearing the right clothes and saying the right things and at the right time. And if I missed my appointment, God wasn't going to show up. He'd say, hey, sorry. See you next time, kid. But the reality is our relationship with God is very similar to our relationships with humans. How do you grow in love? You set aside time together. You go out and you talk to each other. You get to know each other's family. You get to care about each other's hearts, and what excites them starts to excite you. That's what it looks like to have a relationship with Jesus. Get to know him. Spend some time with him. Share your heart and listen for his. At the end of each message, we give time for some reflection or some action. You'll see at each of these stations right here, these are response stations. And they've got on them some bread and some juice so that you can go through and have a time of communion. We do communion once a month together, but this is a time for some self-reflection. You just tear off the bread, dip it in the cup, and reflect, and then take those elements, remembering Jesus' love for you. We also have a place for you to put your connection cards, or if you do your tithe and offering physically, you can place those in the car, in the boxes. And then you can also come up here if you want and just spend some time at the altars reflecting on what God has done for you. And let me share something cool about this that we haven't said yet. Remember when we were doing our Uncharted series, we talked about those little cards that you filled out that had the name of somebody that you were going to pray for, that they would have a transformational encounter with Jesus. And then the name of that person who is a long shot, who you couldn't imagine in a million years coming to Jesus and experiencing his love. Well, just as we said we would do, those cards are now inside this stage. There's over 200 names that are right here in this area. So every time we sing, every time someone steps up here to proclaim the word of God, and every time you come and kneel and pray, you are praying over those names. You are praying over those people. And I want to pray with you and for you as we transition into a time of response. Lord Jesus, God, we are so thankful for who you are. Help us to remember, God, that you didn't go 50-50 with us. You didn't even expect 80-20. God, you said, I am coming down there, kids. And I've got this. God, all you expect from us is a heart of faith. So God, help us to have a new faith in you that starts today. Help us to get rid of the love devourers from our lives. In any areas where we're rude, even if it's just to the AI on our cell phone, or that person in traffic, or that person at the grocery store that we may never see again in our lives, Jesus, but you know, and we need to know, that if we're faithful in those small things, we'll be faithful in greater things. God, help us to get to know somebody, to learn their hearts, to have compassion on where they are in their story. Jesus, help us to seek you in such a way that it transforms all of our other relationships. Jesus, your love is perfect, and you offer up to us an opportunity to get to know your love. Jesus, I pray for each and every one of the names that's in this stage. Names that represent people who are on the hearts of those who are here today, those who are watching online. Names that represent people who are far away from you. God, would they have a transformational encounter with your love? And help us to remember that oftentimes that comes through us, that we get to bear your name. We get to share your hope, and we get to model your love. God, as we enter into this time of response, help us to remember that your body that was broken for us, your blood that was poured out for us, is sufficient to cover everything. Let us just turn back to you. Jesus, it's in your holy, your powerful, your wonderful name that we pray. Amen.